Let's talk about sculpting with oil clay. I'm a big fan of sculpting with an oil-based clay. My preferred oil-based clay is Monster Clay, which comes in these 5-pound bricks. It's usually about 25, maybe 30 bucks. And one of the really great things about it is the shelf life. I've known people that have had their Monster Clay for 15 plus years. So 25 bucks for 15 years worth of use is a hell of a deal. So one of the advantages of an oil-based clay is it never dries out. So this is my organic stormtrooper sculpt that I made last year for Dragon Con. I wound up wanting to redo the mold on this, so I just threw a trash bag over the top and put it up on the shelf. And that highlights one of the great things about an oil-based clay is it never dries out. The only reason why I threw a trash bag on it in the first place was just keep out dog hair, dust, foam dust, things of that nature. So I'm going to walk you through the tools I use. I'm going to walk you through how I clean my clay and filter it after I use it, and how I portion it and store it. And then after that, I'm going to show you how to make a clay board and how to practice learning how to sculpt. So there's three types of monster clay. There's a soft, there's a medium, and a hard. I tend to stick with the medium and hard kinds of monster clay. I'm not a big fan of the soft, but I'm also very heavy-handed with my sculpting and things like that. So don't be afraid to buy some and try it out. Maybe the soft works better for you than it does me. Maybe you can't stand the hard. There's no real wrong answer there. So let's talk tools. One of the favorite tools I like to use is this kidney scraper. It's similar to a rake. So it's got a straight edge on it. A rake will have a lot of grooves on it, and it's a good way to kind of carve out big chunks of clay. This is the main one I use for getting a basic shape going. It is my preferred tool. I did get it in one of those basic kits. I'll have a link down below that you can get for 30 bucks, and it comes with a bunch of tools. I probably use maybe 3 or 4 of those tools from that basic kit. The rest just kind of sit in the drawer. But when you're just starting out, it's a great way to get your hands on some tools and test them out and see how they feel and things like that. There's nothing wrong with buying a kit. You'll probably progress beyond that at a later date. I know I did. I know people that make their own tools. I've made my own tools as time has gone on. So a basic toolkit might not have everything you'll eventually use, but it's a good way to start in the process. So another tool I really dig is this loop and angle tool. So it's got kind of an oval shape on one side and kind of an angled piece on the other. I really enjoy this. This is another tool that I wind up using a lot to get kind of more organic shapes and kind of pulling away smaller chunks of the clay. So something that's very similar to that one is another kind of round and triangle shaped piece. So these are all just basic loop tools, but they're the ones I find I use the most often. So here's another one I really enjoy, and this one has a very thin kind of oval shape to it, and it's got another angle kind of oval shape to it. I tend to favor ovals more than anything else. I don't know why that is. It's just something in my building style I've developed. That might be because I tend to favor more organic sculpts and doing things like that rather than the more mechanical sculpts. Another type of tool that I really enjoy using are the silicone tipped tools. This one's kind of a cone shape. I use it like when the clay is still kind of warm after I've been messing with it for a minute. I'll go in and kind of smooth out lines and kind of tight spots and hide where I've added or taken away clay and those scrape lines and things like that. So this is a really good one. They make another one that's got kind of a triangle edge. So that one's a really good one to kind of feather in places. So the next tool is a ball kind of stylus. So they come in a variety of different sizes. Get something pretty big, about the size of a a large ball bearing, or you can get really kind of fine ball bearing stylists. And this is really good for like putting dimples in things, or kind of, again, like the silicone tool, kind of smoothing places out. The ball stylus I don't use that often. They're more kind of a at the finishing detail kind of point for me. But try them, use them, see what works best for you. So this is a tool I've made myself. It's just a piece of brass tubing, a little wire at the end. And this is a tool I'll use to make wrinkles or skin lines and things like that. I'll throw a piece of thick plastic down on the sculpt, and then I'll just run the tool over it. And it's nothing fancy, but it's something I thought I needed at the time, and it's worked out well for me. So don't be afraid, if you need a tool, to make it yourself. So another set of tools you have is what you use to smooth out the clay once you get your sculpt in a pretty finished state. And that's stuff like this. So this is a butane torch. This is really well at heating up the very top layer. You just want to kind of like quick pops with it is the method I prefer with it. Another technique I'll use is I'll go in with it and then back off, let it cool a bit and pop it kind of like in and out. And what that'll do will create these little air bubbles within the clay to pop, and it'll create little pores and things like that. It's really good at creating like a bone texture, so I really enjoy that. It's also, you can also burn the clay a little bit with that and create another texture, but it's just all about playing around with it and seeing what works. So the heat gun's another really good tool for use for smoothing out monster clay. It's a more deep penetrating heat, and it'll keep the clay softer longer than say the butane torch, which only does the very top layer. Now third up, this is a little alcohol torch. You fill it up with like denatured alcohol. It'll keep the wick wet, and then you just light it on fire and put it. I'm not too big of a fan of it. It works okay, but between the butane torch and the heat gun, I think it's just kind of redundant. I do know people enjoy it a lot, but it's just not something I favor. And finally is chemical smoothing. So using naphtha and a rag. You'll want to wear a respirator because it does have fumes and things like that. And gloves. Highly recommend gloves. You don't want to absorb that stuff through your skin. So you'll take a rag. It can be smooth or textured depending on how you want the smoothing effect to be. I tend to favor really fine paint brushes and just wipe it all down, let it sit. I don't go too heavy with the naphtha. Once I've done a heat gun and I've kind of smoothed it out as best I could, naphtha is my last step. So let's talk melting down clay after you've been using it. So this is what I prefer to use, and it's a fancy little crock pot. $25-$30 at a local grocery store is what I paid for it. I use it exclusively for clay. I know some people would like to heat their clay up in crock pots like I do. Some like to use the microwave. Some like to use the oven or a toaster oven. So I don't recommend using something you cook in to work with clay or silicones or foams or anything like that. I keep those two parts separate from the house. I don't want any accidental overlaps. Some people swear it's fine, but I'm just not going to take the risk on it. So I have separate things for both those. So another way that oil-based clay is different than water-based clay, which you typically use to make pottery or things like that, is as it gets warmer, it becomes more liquid. So my preferred way to heat it up is to use a crock pot. So if I'm heating it up just to mold and shape things and make something, I'll put it on warm. I'll start it first thing in the morning, and then I'll go up and make myself some breakfast, you know, make myself a cup of coffee, and then come down and see how it's doing and go from there. It gives me time to kind of settle into the groove of sculpting. I know some people prefer to just throw theirs in a microwave and put it on for 3 minutes. I don't like doing that because I have found that it heats unevenly. With anything in a microwave, it heats from the middle out. So the top part of the monster clay could be still kind of firm, but the inside could be rather hot. So if you go to poke it, you can wind up poking through that crust into the liquid layer and burn yourself. So if you do use a microwave, there's nothing wrong with it, but it's just not my preferred way. And if you are using one, just be careful. So now let's talk about a couple different settings I use on the Crock-Pot. There's the warm feature, which I just turn it on, leave it, and go start my morning with. And then there's the low feature. Now the low feature is what I use when I want to melt my clay down and then sift it to get rid of any of the hairs, the pieces of plastic paste, silicone, anything like that that could have found its way into it. One thing I'd recommend though is never go higher than low. You can put it on high if you watch it super carefully. I just prefer not to. I'll leave it on low and watch it. If you do put it on high to melt your clay down, you're in some kind of hurry for some reason or something like that, watch it very closely. I don't recommend doing it. The highest I'll go is low, but even low, you've got to keep an eye on because it will bubble, it will boil. And you can, if you throw it on high and you leave it too long with it bubbling and boiling like that, you can damage your clay, make it really kind of crumbly and dried out. So I just stick to warm and low for that. So what I like to do when I clean my clay is I'll melt it down on low, get it a nice liquid, watch it so it doesn't bubble and boil over, kind of give it a good stir, make sure there's no big clumps or anything like that left in it. And then I'll get my different portion pieces out. So I have the original container that the monster clay came in, which is that 5-pound brick. I have a silicone meatloaf tray, and then I have a silicone brownie tray. And I use that to portion out my clay into various sizes. So when filtering the clay, I like to use a fine wire mesh. So once it gets hot enough and starts melting through and dripping down, that is the cleaned out clay, and I will put it in the brownie tray, the meatloaf tray, or the original container, so I have various sizes to work with. So this is how big of a piece the brownie tray produces. And this is great because you can heat it up really quickly, you can play with it in your hand and warm it up if you need to. What I like to do when storing is I'll take a piece like this and I'll just take a piece of aluminum foil. And then just wrap it up. So now it's airtight. Nothing, no hair, no dust, nothing like that can get in it. And I can see what size it is. And then I'll just throw it in a box down here on the shelf. And then when I need it, I'll just grab it. So another tool I like to use, that some maybe not consider a tool, is these synthetic polymer teeth. So what these are little kind of polymer teeth, human sized, and you've got the front teeth on one side, and then you've got molars and things like that on the other side. So it comes in, you've got quite a few sets there, and I really enjoy doing them, and I'll show you how I like to use them in the little demo of the clay board I'm about to do. So let's talk a little bit about making a clay board. What a clay board is just a piece of plywood. It can vary in size. The one I'm doing here is a 12 by 12 piece of plywood. I'm just gonna put a quarter inch of clay on top and then leave myself a border of a quarter inch around the edge of the plywood. You pretty much got a blank canvas here. So what I like to do, especially if I get a new tool and I have a clay board around, is I'll go and play with it and see how the tool reacts, see how I like it, what I could possibly use it for, things like that. If you're just starting out and you have a clay board and you want to practice sculpting something, there is nothing wrong with just sculpting a nose and a mouth on the clay board and having fun with it. So if you require that more structured classroom environment to learn rather than just kind of jumping in like I do, I highly recommend checking out the Stan Winston School. They have online courses. There's even one on making a clay board and starting sculpting and learning different practices and techniques. It's taught by Don Lanning. And it's an excellent course, and I highly recommend you check it out. So hopefully you guys enjoyed the video. If you did, hit that like button, smash that subscribe button, and I'll see you next time.